The Christmas Jinty, an original Christmas story adaptation by Percy Laveau Six. It snowed down that December at Newton Abbot Station. Everywhere was covered with a fresh blanket of soft snow. The engines hurried along, bustling to prepare for the festive holidays. Passengers and parcels had to be delivered, the station was being decorated, and occasionally you caught notes of guitars or sleigh bells drifting from the shedmaster's office. Caitlin and Hercule couldn't hear it, though. They were delivering coal to Morton Hampstead Station. Hercule stood with a plough on his front, watching the coal being unloaded, whilst Caitlin was nestled behind him, blowing off steam and watching the sky in awe as the stars twinkled above her.
"You do love your sky, don't you, Kate?"
Hercule smiled. Caitlin jumped.
Yes I do. It's so pretty.
Yep. That's one of the nice things about winter. The skies. Especially at night. The young engine couldn't help but agree.
So, Kate, looking forward to the day you can take your own train?
Caitlin paused. The shedmaster had said that since she was doing so well as station pilot, she might be allowed to pull her own train soon. The Jinty was excited, but nervous. She was used to, and built for yard work, and she thought she might not handle the traffic as easily as the others did. Hercule understood how she felt.
"Hey, I know it sounds scary at first, but it's not actually that bad. As a matter of fact, I think you'd do just fine."
"You do?"
Caitlin whistled excitedly.
"Sure," the bigger engine puffed. "Just keep your smoke box screwed on and you'll do fine."
Caitlin thought about this over and over as she and Hercule made their way home. The day she got to take her own train. That'll be something to remember. Back on shed, the engines were chatting merrily about tomorrow. Christmas Day.
"I hear that it'll snow a little more tomorrow," mused Duchess.
"I can't wait for the lights to go up," cheered Louise. "I'll bet the passengers will be so happy to see it."
"Speaking of passengers, I also hear that the Southwestern is running again," Duchess smiled. "Apparently it's running to us via Morton Hampstead from Bristol, and then it goes on to Plymouth via Totnes."
Caitlin was puzzled.
"What's a Southwestern?" she whispered.
"A Christmas special that runs round Devon like a headless chicken dropping off folk as it goes," said Lizzie briefly.
"Come on, Lizzie, where's your festive spirit? The Southwestern is the best train ever," giggled Louise wildly.
"Yeah, well, it's nutters like you who take it too far. Bah humbug," Lizzie grumbled.
Whilst the other engines continued to chat, Caitlin was left to herself, lost in her imagination.
Maybe, just maybe,
Christmas Day dawned bright and warm with snow all around. Children could be heard laughing and playing from the nearby park, and cars cautiously crawled over the black roads. The station was busily prepared for the Southwestern's arrival. The tracks were hastily cleared, lights were hung out, a tree was placed on the end of the platform, tinsel adorned the doorways, and everyone stood back waiting for the announcement. Caitlin thought the train would never arrive. Finally,
The train now arriving on platform one from Bristol Temple Meads is the 10:15 Southwestern Christmas Express passenger special to Plymouth. Please keep away from the edge of the platform. Season's greetings from Newton Abbot Station and Great Western Railway.
The train soon glided in. A polished, shining castle class came in first, pulling four luxurious coaches behind him. All were very impressed.
"That castle," drooled Louise.
"Isn't it marvellous?" sighed Duchess.
Lizzie didn't say anything, but a small smile played upon her features. Even she had to admit that the train looked stunning.
An hour had passed. The engines were all gossiping loudly when the station master hurried across the line. He spoke to them urgently. "Everyone, listen. One of the regular trains to Moreton Hampstead has snowed under. Duchess, Lizzie and Hercule, you lot are on rescue duty."
"Me, sir?" asked Hercule quickly.
"Louise isn't as strong as you, and with Julie up at Newcastle, you're the best we have. Come on, chop chop!"
"Let's move out, everybody," Duchess called.
And everybody set out, leaving Louise, Caitlin and the castle behind. He looked over to Caitlin with concern.
"Does this happen often?"
I don't know, really."
"Don't know much, do you?" he smirked.
"Too right she doesn't,"
the prairie sniffed, trying to impress the castle.
"Caitlin only came to us in September."
The castle seemed to be deep in thought before he returned his gaze to Caitlin, who still looked very shy. "Only 4 months. What do you do, Jinty?"
"Me? I'm the station pilot."
Impressive. All the engines suddenly stopped and looked on as a workman hurried into the yard, hands on his knees and panting heavily with exhaustion. "We need the visiting engine at the rescue site now," he said.
"But my train," protested the castle. "It needs to leave for Totnes in a quarter of an hour."
"Another engine will have to take it," the workman said dismissively as he clambered into the castle's cab. The engine pulled miserably away. Caitlin and Louise were worried.
What if the castle didn't make it back in time to take his train?
"I'll take it," the small prairie said dutifully. "It's only fair that I should be responsible for a castle's train."
"But what if you can't make it?" Caitlin said.
"What do you mean?"
"Well, what if you're not strong enough? Or if you got snowed under and..."
"Caitlin, please. Surely you know me better than that."
Louise was loftily surprised.
"Have you ever known me to fail on a passenger train in times of need?"
A whistle interrupted the two engines as a dirty pannier tank passed by with a coal train.
"Let's not forget the time your injectors failed, right, Louise, before you took that director's special in June?"
Louise blushed.
"Well, I..."
A larger prairie stopped in the station with a commuter train.
"And let's not forget the hot box you ran last week on your locals," he jeered.
Shut up, Louise hissed.
"There was that one time where your sounding gear failed," said Caitlin innocently.
Shut up, Louise burst out. "That was completely accidental. Say no more of the subject."
But...
Hush!
Just then, the shedmaster came up to the two tank engines. It was now snowing fiercely, and the sky was almost black.
"Listen, girls," he called. "The Southwestern's due to leave in 10 minutes, and the castle's still not back. I've called up the Totnes station master, and together we only have one available option."
"I take the train. I knew that I'd be chosen to take the Southwestern safely through."
"Get real, Louise," said the shedmaster. "You wouldn't even get a third of the way by yourself. No, what we're going to do is we're going to pull off a top and tail formation, with you at the back and Caitlin leading on at the front."
"Top and tail?
Oh, Brunel, help me,"
groaned Louise. "Can you do it, young'un?"
Caitlin thought long and hard. She'd never done anything like this before. It was nearly a blizzard outside too, but a train needed to get to its destination, and she couldn't let the passengers down. They'd be wanting to get back to their families for the remainder of the Christmas holidays.
"I've never really done this before, but I'll try my best."
"Good engine," the shedmaster cheered. "I knew you'd help us."
"Rust quicker, will you?"
Louise muttered as the two set off. Soon, both Caitlin and Louise were heading for Totnes at a comfortable, snappy speed. The night and the snow made the trip seem almost impossible,
but the two forged on. Caitlin wore a gold and red headboard and a decorated wreath on her smoke box, and her lights blazed brightly against the snow. Louise barked behind her, also wearing a wreath, calling to her younger partner to occasionally see how they were doing.
How are you, Caitlin? Everything okay up there? Louise, I can't see beyond the end of my buffers. Doing well then.
Poor Caitlin coughed and spluttered as she battled on through the snow. She was thankful she had Louise to help her. She was half blinded and very tired after working all morning with Hercule. She wanted to stop, but she knew she couldn't do that. The passengers needed to get to their destinations. Besides, everyone was counting on her to do a good job. At Totnes, the station master paced the platform. The Southwestern was due in 10 minutes, and there had been no word of its progress. The weather had been getting progressively worse, and had somehow managed to cut off the telephone lines along the route between the final signal box and the station. Passengers and relatives gathered on the platform, wondering where their loved ones could be. The station master checked his watch. 5 minutes to 9 o'clock. He blew on his hands and stuffed them into his pockets, watching the line stretching into the distance before him. He began to worry that the train might never actually turn up at all. Finally, a tiresome whistle called out, and the grating sound of two engines barking could be heard approaching. Everyone watched, and then gave up a mighty cheer as two tank engines pulled in. The crowd swarmed around the coaches, and staff had to shoo them away. Both crews were heartily congratulated by all who came near them, and offers were made for them to rest up at the station. Louise panted, letting off steam. She was worn out and cold, but she managed to smile as the crowds continued to cheer.
You hear that? We've made it, Caitlin. We've made it.
The Jinty didn't reply. She didn't have any steam left to answer. She was red in the face and absolutely exhausted. She'd never travelled that far at that speed before, and she felt so shaky that she thought her wheels would fall off. But she knew, deep down, that she'd done proud. The next day, everyone left for work as usual, leaving a very small, tired Jinty still asleep at the back of the shed. When Caitlin woke up a little while later, she was surprised to see that she was the only one left on shed.
Where is everyone? She wondered.
They're at work, girl, said her driver.
Work? What do you mean they're all at work already? I had no idea. Why didn't you wake me up?
Shh, easy, easy, the driver soothed. It's all taken care of. Now come on, we need to speak to the station master.
Why?
Because he wants to see us. Now come on. The station master was waiting for them when they arrived. Caitlin expected him to be angry with her for missing out the morning's work. But she actually saw that he was smiling.
Well, Caitlin, I heard all about yours and Louise's run with the Southwestern, and I'm proud of you.
Proud, sir?
Yes. That was your first passenger service of your career, and I heard that you performed brilliantly. Such an achievement deserves to be praised.
Caitlin smiled.
Thank you, sir.
I also heard that you were very tired.
Caitlin looked down at the ballast, thinking she'd done something wrong.
I was, sir, she mumbled. I've never gone that far before, and I've never gone so fast. I really wanted to stop and rest, but I couldn't because everyone would be cross with me. Everyone wanted to be together for Christmas, so I knew I needed to do my best for them, sir.
The station master shook his head, but he smiled again.
That's true commitment, that is, Caitlin. You should feel proud of yourself. I can tell you're going to become a loyal addition to this fleet.
Really, sir?
Absolutely. You're honest,
hard-working and brave. I can tell you'll be something special. And with that, the station master turned and left. Caitlin blushed at the compliment, grinning happily.
Come on, Kate, back to work, called her driver, settling himself at the controls.
Caitlin moved off, spurred on by the praise she'd received. And between you and me, I don't think her first Christmas could have ended much better.
Do you?